Good morning, everyone. So continuing from our last lecture, today we are going to discuss the scheduling algorithms that a operating system can employ to schedule the different processes. So as we all know, the processor is a very rare commodity in a computer system. All the processes strive for a CPU and make request for the use of CPU. But most of the system carry only one central processing unit or the processor. So it can be only allocated to one process at a time. So we have to different scheduling algorithms to implement those. So the first type of algorithm is the first come first serve scheduling algorithm, or the FCFS. It is a non-preemptive type of scheduling algorithm, meaning that a processor that is allocated to one process can only be taken back after that process has completed its execution, or if that process releases it voluntarily. So how to implement this? So consider this example that we have. This is a table showing four different types of processes with their process ID P1, P2, P3, P4. This column denotes the arrival time, or the time at which the process has made the request for the CPU, and this denotes the burst time. This denotes for how long each process wants to use the CPU. For example, P1 process has made the request for the CPU at time t equals to 0, and for time t equals to 3 seconds, it needs that processor to complete its execution. So this table contains all the different arrival times and burst times of each process. So we have to calculate the average waiting time of the system and average turnaround time of the system. So how to solve this? First, we have to make a Gantt chart. Gantt chart, named after the scientist that developed this technique. So we have to develop a Gantt chart. At time t equals to 0, only one process wants the CPU, and that process is P1. So because there is no competition, we allocate that process to that CPU to process P1. So at time t equals to 0, P1 is allocated to the CPU. This being the non-preemptive type of scheduling, the CPU can only be taken back after that process has completed its execution. So at time t equals to 0, the CPU is allocated to P1, and it wants the processor to be used for 3 seconds. So from time 0 to 3, the CPU is allocated to P1. After it has completed its execution, we check which process was next in line. So the next process to arrive, or the next process to make the request for the CPU, is at time t equals to 2, and that request has been made by process P2. So we allocate the CPU to process P2 at time t equals to 3. Although it requested the process at 2, we can only allocate it at time t equals to 3, because before that it was not free. So from time t equals to 3, its burst time is 4. So we allocate that processor at 3, and 3 plus 4 is 7. So time t equals to 7 will denote the ending of process P2. The next request is by process P3, and it will receive the processor at 7 for time t equals to 5. For 7 to 12, we have allocated the CPU to process P3. Similarly, for process P4, we allocate it to at time t equals to 4 till time t equals to 14. At time t equals to 14, all the processes has completed their execution, and hence we can calculate the waiting time of the system. So the waiting time for process P1 is the amount of time it has waited in the ready queue. This process has started its execution at time t equals to 0 and made the request at time t equals to 0. So it did not wait for any time, so its waiting time is 0. Moving on to P2. P2 was allocated the CPU at time t equals to 3, but it made the request at time t equals to 2. So in reality, it waited for 1 second before receiving the CPU. So its waiting time is 1. Similarly, waiting time of P3 received the CPU at time t equals to 7 and made the request at time t equals to 4. So in reality, it waited for 3 seconds before beginning its execution. Similarly, for P4, starting its execution at 12 and make the P4 process made its request at time t equals to 6. So it waited for 6 seconds before it starting its execution. So this is the different waiting time of the different processes. The total waiting time of the system is waiting time of P1 plus waiting time of P2 plus waiting time of P3 plus waiting time of P4. So the total waiting time is 10 seconds or milliseconds, whatever the units are. The average waiting time of the system is total waiting time divided by the number of processes. The total waiting time has already been calculated. It is 10 seconds or 10 milliseconds, and the number of processes are 4. So the average waiting time comes out to be 2.5 seconds or 2.5 units. Similarly, the turnaround time for each process is equal to the waiting time of that process plus the burst time of that process. So the waiting time of P1, as we calculated before, was 0, and the burst time of P1 is already given, it is 3. So it comes out to be 3. So turnaround time of P2 was 1 plus 4, 5. Turnaround time for P3 is its waiting time plus its burst time, and turnaround time for P4 is its waiting time 2 seconds and its burst time, which is given equal to its waiting time is 6 seconds and its burst time, that is 2 seconds. So it comes out to be 8. So the average waiting time is total waiting time plus the number of processes. The average turnaround time is total turnaround time of that system divided by the number of processes. So the total turnaround time is 8 plus 8, 16 plus 8, 24 divided by 4, which comes out to be 6. So this is the total turnaround, average turnaround time of the system. Average waiting time is 2.5 milliseconds or seconds, and average turnaround time is 6 seconds. This type of scheduling is known as non-preemptive scheduling. There are other scheduling algorithms also. The major drawback of this scheduling is important process cannot be executed first, because priority does not matter in this type of algorithm. The process that requested the CPU first will allocate the CPU first. The second disadvantage of this type of scheduling is it provides a very high average waiting time for the system. We can overcome one of these problems by using another scheduling algorithm, that is SJF scheduling algorithm, meaning shortest job first scheduling algorithm. It can be implemented preemptively or non-preemptively. Shortest job first scheduling algorithm. If we take the same numerical again, or if we take another example of the same type, this type of scheduling . The same approach goes for this algorithm as well. We have to make a Gantt chart. In this case, we have to take one thing in account: the job that has the least burst time will be the first one to be executed. So if we solve this numerical, we allocate the processor to that process which has the least burst time, the shortest amount of burst time. So in this algorithm, at time t equals to 0, only one process has demanded the CPU. So we allocate that process at time t equals to 0. The next process is at time t equals to 2. At time t equals to 2, this process will have remaining burst time of 1 second. And this process will have remaining burst time of 6 seconds. So we continue with P1. So from 0 to 3, P1 will execute. At 3 seconds, we have only one process available, that is P2. So we start with P2. Here is where the difference kicks in. This type of scheduling is preemptive scheduling. We can take the CPU after once it has been allocated. At time t equals to 3, we start P2. But at 4, we receive the request from process P3. At time t equals to 4, the remaining burst time of this process will be 5 seconds. It is 6, and after completion of 1 unit, it will remain as 5. And this has a burst time of 4. So we stop the process and continue with this process. So at time t equals to 4, P2 is preempted with remaining burst time of 5. Originally it was 6, and after completion of 1 unit, it has come down to 5. And this process has burst time of 4. So we start with P3. At time t equals to 4. We started the next process to arrive or to make the request is at time t equals to 6. At 6, remaining burst time of P3 will be 2, and remaining burst time of this process which has not started its execution is 2. But we continue with P3 because it was the first one to arrive. So we continue with P3 process till its completion. So starting at 4 and its burst time is 4 seconds, so it will complete at 8 seconds. Its burst time is reduced to 0, this process has reduced to 0. At 8 seconds we again have 2 processes. This has a burst time of 5 and this has a burst time of 2. So we continue with P4 process. Now no process can interrupt this process. No other process can interrupt this process because after 6 no other process has been given. So we continue with P4 and we execute it completely till 10 seconds. After 3 processes completed their execution, only one process is remaining, and we start it again P2. Remaining burst time is 5. It was 6 original, but it is now 5. So from 10 to 15 we schedule process P2. So in this way we can complete its execution. This is the preemptive approach. SGF can also be implemented as non-preemptive algorithm, but then it will lose its advantage. So again we calculate the waiting time for process P1. Waiting time for P1. P1 started its execution at 0 and it requested the CPU at time t equals to 0. So in reality it waited for 0 seconds. Similarly, waiting time for P2. P2 started its execution at 3 seconds and it made the request at 2 seconds. So 3 minus 2 is 1 second. Similarly for process P3. Also P2 has not completed its execution. So after 1 second, it has one more cycle to go. It starts its second cycle at time t equals to 10. Time t equals to 10. And the time at which it released the CPU. So it started at 3 and released it at 4. So 10 minus 4, it is the process P2 is in waiting state. So 10 minus 4 is 6 seconds. So the total is 7 seconds it has waited for CPU. Similarly, for process P3, P3 started its execution at 4 seconds and it made the request at 4. So 4 minus 4 is 0. So it has waited for 0 second. Now coming down to P4. P4 started its execution at 8 milliseconds or second. And it made the request for CPU, it demanded the CPU at 6 seconds. So it comes down to 2 seconds. Adding all this, the total waiting time of the system is 7 plus 2, 9. So 9 seconds. And average waiting time is 9 divided by 4, which comes out to be 2.25. Again, wait turnaround time for P1. It's burst time plus waiting time. Waiting time is 0 and burst time is 3. So for P1 it is 3. P2 and P3 and so forth and so on. For P2 the burst time is 5, 6 in fact. 6 is the burst time and 4 and 2. And the waiting time is 7, 0 and 2. 7 is its waiting time. For this it is 0 and this. So this is the total turnaround time. Comes out to be 8, 16 and 8, 24. The average waiting time, average turnaround time in fact, is 24 by 4 is 6. This type of scheduling provides the least waiting time among all the different algorithms, because we schedule the shortest job first and then we schedule those jobs which are larger. So the larger job waits for less amount of time. This results in very less waiting time. Also it increases the throughput. Throughput is given as the number of jobs completed per unit time. So if the smaller jobs are scheduled first, they will complete quickly. So it reduces the throughput or increases the throughput because waiting time is less. The third type of scheduling algorithm is priority scheduling algorithm. The two disadvantages of FCFS were important jobs could not be completed first and waiting time was high. One of the problem was taken care of SJF, or in preemptive terms we can say SRTN or SRTF, shortest remaining time first. At every second we check which process is the smallest or shortest burst time. The third one is the priority scheduling algorithm. As the name indicates, it schedules those jobs first which have the highest priority. Taking another example, so one more column can be added which shows the priority of that particular process. Let's say burst time are given as follows. So the priority of this process is 1. The priority of this process is 2. This process has a priority of 4 and this process has a priority of 3. And let's consider arrival time to be 0. Or we can have any arrival time. Alright. Again, preparing a Gantt chart for this system. In this case, the process that has the highest priority, that is process number 3, P3, it has a priority or rank of first. So this is the most important process of the system. So it is the first one to be scheduled. At time t equals to 0, we schedule this process, P3. It will run from 0 to 7 seconds because its burst time is 7. After this has completed, we move on to the next priority. Next is the process P2. It has the second highest priority. So this is the second process to be scheduled. From time 7 equals to its burst time is 4. So we schedule it from 7 to 11. After moving on, we have only P1 and P4. This has a priority of 3. Effectively its priority is 1 because now there are only 2 processes. So this is the 1 priority process and this is priority 2 process. So we schedule P1. From 11 to its burst time is 5 to 11 to 16. And lastly, we have only one process left and we schedule that process. It has a burst time of 2 seconds, so from 16 to 18. Calculating the waiting time for different process, P1 waited for 0 seconds, P2 waited for 7 seconds, this is P3 process. P2 waited for 7 seconds, P1 waited for 11 seconds, and P4 waited for 16 minus 0 or 16 seconds. Total waiting time is 11 and 7, 18 and 16, 34. So the average waiting time is 36 divided by 4, which comes out to be 9 minutes. Similarly, turnaround time for P1, its burst time plus its waiting time. Waiting time is 0 and burst time is for P1 5 seconds. For P2 its burst time is 4 seconds and waiting time is 7 seconds. For P3 the burst time is 7 seconds. P3 7 seconds is the burst time and waiting time is 0. And P1 has waited for 11 seconds. We have scheduled P3 first and then P1. Similarly, for P4 it has waited for 16 seconds and burst time is 2 seconds. So these are the turnaround times of different scheduling, different processes. We can calculate the average turnaround time in the same method, by the same method. Priority algorithm tackles some of the problems that are caused by other scheduling algorithms. But one problem that it creates by itself is the starvation problem. Starvation problem. At runtime, different processes will make the request for CPU, and the lower priority process will be pushed further down the chain. After many process has made their request, a situation may arise when one process will not receive the CPU even after waiting for too large amount of time. That condition is known as starvation. We can use another scheduling algorithm where starvation problem will not occur and everyone is given the same amount of time. That approach is known as round robin scheduling. In this method, each process is given equal amount of time whether it has completed its execution or not. If its execution is not completed in that time, which is known as time quantum, if it does not complete its execution in that time, we forcefully take the CPU and allocate it to another process. After some time, that process will receive the quantum again and it can continue its execution from the time where it left off. Suppose, let's take an example where time quantum is mentioned as 2 seconds. So, starting this algorithm, a Gantt chart is prepared. The quantum for this type of, for this example, will be 2 seconds or 2 milliseconds. At time t equals to 0, we schedule process P1 for 2 seconds. So from 0 to 2, P1 will run. It will not complete its execution in 2 seconds because its burst time or execution time is 5 seconds. So at 2 seconds, we preempt that process and allocate the CPU to someone else. So the remaining burst time will be 3 seconds. At 2 seconds, we schedule P2 for further 2 seconds. At 4 seconds, we schedule P3 from 4 seconds to 6 seconds, its remaining burst time will be 5 seconds. Similarly, for P4, it will complete its task because its burst time is 2 and quantum given is also 2. So it will complete its task in 2 seconds. So from 6 to 8, we schedule P4 and it will not be again, it will not be executed again because it has completed its execution. Coming back to P1, this time also it will get a 2 second quantum. Its remaining burst time will be 1. Initially it was 5, then 3, and now its remaining burst time is 1. For P2, a 2 second quantum will be enough to complete its execution. Moving on to P3, it will run from 12 seconds to 14 seconds and its burst time remaining is 3 seconds. P4 doesn't get a chance because its execution is complete. Again, moving on to P1, now this is interesting. P1 has remaining burst time of 1 and the quantum is 2. So it will run from 14 seconds to time equals to 15 seconds. From 15 we will schedule P3. We will not be waiting till 16 seconds because CPU cannot be afforded to keep idle. So at 15 seconds we schedule process P3 for 2 seconds because quantum is 2. Even if there is only one process remaining in the queue, we can only give a quantum of 2 seconds. At 17 seconds we provide another opportunity to process P3 to complete its execution and it will do so. So at 18 seconds all the processes completed their execution. Now coming to the waiting time part, P1 process has, all the process has taken multiple chances to complete their execution. So the burst time, the waiting time will be the accumulation of all the waiting time that has spent, that it has spent in the ready queue. So for the first cycle, it started its execution at 0 and it wanted the processor at 0. So for this cycle, its waiting time is comes out to be 0, but it has not completed its execution. For next cycle, it received the CPU at 8 and released it at 2. So this is the waiting time for the next cycle. Next time, it started its execution at 14 and released the CPU at 10. For P2, 2 is the start time of its execution and demand for the processor was made at 0 seconds. In the second instance, it started at 10 and released the CPU at 4. It only took 2 chances. Similarly for P3. P3 started its execution at 4 but demand was made at 0 second. In the next turn, it started its execution at 12 and released the CPU at 6. In the next turn, it started its execution at 15 and release the CPU at 14. And this cycle obviously 17 minus 17 because it continued after 17. For P4, 6 was the start point of its execution. The CPU was requested at 0 second and it took only one chance, one iteration only. So this is it. The total waiting time comes out to be 6 seconds for this cycle and 4 seconds. So 10 seconds for this process. Pair 2 plus 6, 8 seconds for this process. P3, 4 plus 6, 10 plus 1, 11, and this is it. And this took only one chance, so 6. So the total waiting time of this system is 10 plus 8, 18 plus 11, 29 plus 6, 35. So the average waiting time is 35 divided by number of processes, which comes out to be 8.75. Alright, and for the average turnaround time, the same method that we used, calculate the waiting time, add it to the burst time, and that provides us to the turnaround time of that system. Calculate the total turnaround time and divide it by the number of processes. That will give you the average turnaround time of that system.